We have seen already importance of technology in making realization of integrated circuits and now systems. The course really now starts. The way I organized it is something like this. Since the starting material for all integrated circuit is silicon chips, mostly we are working at, and therefore the starting material is silicon. And so we'll see first how silicon is obtained. Okay. Once we know how silicon can be achieved, or best silicon or pure silicon is available in particular form I want, then I'll say, okay, take this so-called silicon wafers inside the clean room or inside the lab where actually fab is going to be done. Then we discuss therefore something about the conditions in the fab labs, which are called clean rooms. So we'll then discuss something more about clean rooms. Then we'll also see there that, you know, when the silicon comes packaged from elsewhere many times, though it seems very clean, it's very polished surface and everything, but it still has many other impurities, particularly organic ones. So the first thing before any processing starts, we have to clean the wafers, and there is a standard procedure of cleaning. And we'll see what are those procedures and how silicon is ready for the actual processing. In most cases, the first process is normally oxidation, but maybe we'll do something more about diffusion because some part of the diffusion characteristics are required in oxidation. So we'll first start studying about the incorporation of impurities, which is called diffusion of impurities in silicon. Followed by, we will talk about oxidations, variety of kinds. And once we did oxidation, we look for lithography, we look for metal, other depositions, metal depositions, etchings. All this will follow as if we are actually working inside the lab and we are trying to realize. And then I will show you how many masks, as we will say later, are required to realize some kind of a CMOS chip or even a MOS chip. Typically, you may require around, as I said, 400 steps, 4 to 450 steps, and the masking may be as low as 16 mask process or can be as high as 34 or 36 mask process. So, we'll go into one by one. A crystal per se is a solid material of three kinds. Every solids are available in three kinds. One, of course, is the state is called amorphous. The second is called polycrystalline and third is called crystalline. The difference between the three is something like this. Please remember, all atoms in a solid are arranged in a particular manner and their arrangement itself decides the kind of material, whether it is amorphous, polycrystalline or crystalline. I may start with the lowest one, crystalline first. Crystalline materials are those whose atomic arrangement is such that they are periodic in nature, that is fixed atomic arrangement repeats all sides. So this is called periodic structure for crystalline materials. So there is a periodicity, every lattice, we'll word this word soon, every such smallest cell which is repeated is called lattice, and there is a lattice periodicity which creates a solid. So you can see from here, there are atoms in particular order are fixed, and they are bonded exactly as they are nearest possible, bonding is possible. So this is called crystalline materials. So this is called orderly materials. If there is no order of atomic arrangement, then we say such materials are amorphous in nature. Okay. Most things which you use many a times other than metals are mostly amorphous in nature. Most compounds are amorphous in nature. For example, silicon dioxide, which is the most important material for us in IC processing, is generally available only in the amorphous style. However, if I crystallize it, what is it called? Yes?
Quartz.
In between also there is something, but we'll come to it later. Okay. So quartz. So quartz is a crystalline SiO2. Whereas we are looking for right now amorphous material, which is silicon dioxide as amorphous. This is used often, okay. And in between this, if there is a partial order, that is the direction of lattice are different, there are a number of such crystals in one area, then we say it is polycrystalline. Even this material is required in IC processing. So all three, please remember these, though most of the time we talk about crystalline materials, the other two also play a lot of role in our fabrication. In particular, if you look for solar cell these days, we were working most of the time on crystalline silicon there to make a solar cell. The cost of making crystal is very high, as we shall see today. And to reduce the cost, if the process which allows the films to be deposited, which are amorphous in nature, is much cheaper. And solar cell people's major activity or major work is what they call as watts per cent or cents per watt. That is, how many cent per watt is cost or how many watts per cent you can create is the figure of merit for them. Cheaper the one, that is larger watts in smaller cents or smaller cents in larger watts, is essentially what is the feature of a good solar cell. Since the amorphous films are much cheaper to make and much cheaper in cost otherwise, they may be the best candidate as far as the low cost solar cells are concerned. However, if anything is good, there will be something wrong. So they are very poor in efficiencies, and therefore if you look for higher efficiency solar cell conversion of optical energy into electrical, then the crystalline is the best. And there is a microcrystalline also, which is close to polycrystalline, better than amorphous, little worse than polycrystalline is called this. And these also are these days work for increasing little cost but better efficiency. So if we look into the solar cell area later, if time permitting this year, I don't know, then we will see that there also material choices are very crucial. Silicon ICs per se, starting material is always crystalline silicon, and we will like to see how that is created in actual way. As I just now said, arrangement of atoms in solid is called arrangement of lattices. One single arrangement which is periodic in nature is called one lattice. Most semiconductors like silicon, germanium, 3-5 compound semiconductor like gallium arsenide, indium arsenide, indium phosphide, gallium phosphide, these are compound semiconductors, 3-5 materials as they are famously called, they all show crystalline arrangement. And normally they have what they call the kind of lattice which they show is cubic in nature. Okay. Of course, in the cubic itself, I will show you other lattices little later. The simple cubic, there is only one material which is popularly known. There are maybe few, at least I could only gather one. Polonium, which is more radioactive material, is essentially has a simple cubic structure. Okay, I'll show you lattices little later. Then there is an arrangement called body-centered cubic. The materials which are known in this kind of lattices is tungsten, molybdenum, tantalum. There is a third possible arrangement, which is face-centered cubic, copper, gold, silver, platinum. And of course, this zinc blend has one more possibility, which is called diamond. Diamond essentially is slight variation of zinc blend, but it is classified in the same. Silicon lattice is diamond lattice, whereas gallium arsenide is a zinc blend lattice. Okay. So what is the purpose of these lattices? Since these are the arrangement possible in atoms, we are interested to know if particular kind of lattice exists, and if I want to create a material of different kind. For example, for electrical conductivity, we expect that the material should be either n-type or p-type. That is, it should have excess electrons or excess holes so that the current can actually transport. Now, this idea that only semiconductors allow you these two bipolar transport is very important. Metals only show electron transports. Insulators do not show any transport. If at all they show, they will show electron transport, but very difficult transport. So the materials which are used in everything in this integrated circuit area essentially is either p-type semiconductor or an n-type semiconductor, and therefore how the semiconductors can be doped that to make it p-type, n-type is also part of this crystal growth. Initial wafer or initial substrate should be doped to a given value. This given value and type of dopant is very, very crucial in actually making the device. So this fact has to be understood by you, that why we are so much worried about this is the fact, if you look at the electrical characteristics of a MOS transistor, you can see the threshold voltage of a MOS transistor is given by, for n-channel device, VTN, phi ms plus 2 phi f minus qox by cox, I will name the term minus q bulk divided by cox, 2 phi f is 2 kt by q ln ne or nd by ni, depends on what you have, a type, acceptor type or donor type. Q bulk essentially is q na e xd, xd is the depletion layer, maybe max, xd max is equal to twice Ks epsilon naught upon some phi f, okay, 2 phi f upon q n a or d. So you can see from here, if I want to control the threshold voltage of n channel device as shown here, or p channel, either of them, then I must be able to have fixed value of acceptors or donor concentration in the substrate. Because if NAs are in or NDs are constant, only then phi f is constant, the bulk charges are constant, and therefore to fix a VT, I must have a process which will fix my initial concentration in the wafer. Okay. So one technique which will allow the substrate to have a known concentration is to dope the crystal during its growth itself. Okay. And that otherwise, of course, we will go into other process called epitaxial growths. But we will see this later. So essentially I say concentration of wafer is a very, very important parameter many a times in deciding the electrical property of a transistors. In the case of bipolar, the base width and the base doping again decides the gain of a bipolar transistor. So again the doping in the base in specific is very, very crucial to design the beta of a transistor. So in some sense, starting material resistivity or starting material donors or acceptor concentration is very crucial to us. And therefore, how do we dope the crystal? Okay. So these are the issues which we will like to solve in the coming time, coming hour. Okay. So the lattices, why I am worried about lattices? Because lattices has a minimum amount of volume in which so many atoms are residing. Now, if I want to introduce an impurity, there is no volume there, okay. So where will it go, okay. So there will be something where these so-called impurity atoms like phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, boron, aluminium, which are the dopants for P or N type, N or P type, can get in. And how do they get in? And they uniformly distribute everywhere, because crystal will have a large volumes or large areas in many cases. And so we want to have uniform doping everywhere. That's our major worry. How uniform are you really uniform? So understanding a lattice has some advantage, because then we know how much of the possible external atoms can come in without actually disturbing the periodicity of the lattice. If crystal breaks or it dissociates, then it will go to polycrystalline or even amorphous. The problem with amorphous semiconductor to crystalline is, because in most electrical characteristics of any device, if you see very carefully, if it is a MOS transistor, the drain to source current is mu into Cox into voltages. So there is a modality term appearing. If you look at bipolar transistors, the diffusion coefficient of the carriers, minority carriers in the base, there the D is related to mobility by Einstein relation, say let's say dn. So the mobility of the carriers essentially are going to decide the available current in the both bipolar and MOS transistors. And therefore, we like to see the material should have a known mobility or at least controllable mobility. Okay, and only then I can fix the current. Why I am interested so much in mobility control? Because if I am working a circuit, let's say, what is that? Let's say simple MOS circuit I take. Typical MOS transistor looks something like this. I am only giving you a cross section width. This is a n-channel device. Okay. This is gate oxide. This is my gate. This is my drain. These crosses are metal connections, sources. This is bulk. The current is actually electrons are moving under when I apply VDS, apply VGS. I create an inversion channel, hopefully if VGS exceed threshold, then source is grounded, VDS is positive, electrons move from source to drain because of the drift field. There is an electric field in this direction and the electrons move towards drain. Okay. Now these electrons through the channel, they are moving, and I want this current to be known to me because I will decide if I have a capacitor as my load. Okay, this is my resistor. When I say I want a circuit to be faster, I want charging to be faster and I want discharge to be faster. Obviously, the current made available to you from the power supply and the one which is grounded down from the capacitor discharge, both are important to improve the speed of the circuit. So, current control is our major aim. So, please do not think that this so-called metallurgy, chemistry, material science which I teach has no relevance, because we are actually looking at my circuit, which is what is driving me to do all this. 2000 till maybe 90, most of the electrical engineers were also doing fabrication. Up last 20 years, chemical engineers have taken our role, though we are still the ones who probably manage them and tell them what we want and how you should do. But of late, I figured out, for example, Intel's last chief was also a chemical engineer. Okay, so it's not true that only electrical can go. But the idea is that study of a circuit essentially forces me to study devices. Devices I want to finally make from somewhere, and I must know all technology to make it so that so-called circuit performance or a system performance is guaranteed. Is that clear? I will like to make my technology independent of a designer as much as I try, so that this designer should not actually ask me, what did you do? Okay, he said, these are my parameters I gave you, use them and design your chip. But things are not becoming so simple. We need to know what is happening in technology. Designers must know, and what designers can do also technology must take care. And therefore, now understanding of technology for designers is as much relevant in 22 nanometer node and below as much it was earlier in 0.5 or 1 micron nodes. Technology people were told, you do what you like, tell us what is your limits. Designer will say, I'll use that, don't worry. Okay, now it's not so much true. So study of technology is still relevant now, or rather it has become more relevant now, which was earlier in 70s or 60s, much more stronger separate disciplines. Okay, so please remember that all our thinking has something to do with this circuit, and it's not just material which I am studying, but as an electrical engineer, I will like to know, if I had to achieve this, what should I make a choice for? Okay, and that choice is something you must understand. So many people get bored with these courses many times, too much chemistry, chemical and things goes on, but they are part of the system, you know. And in a system, you cannot say, I will only use this part of the system. System is a system, okay. Okay, so first thing, let me first go to lattices. So how do you construct a crystal? Once you specify the lattice, you can then hang a collection of atoms of each position in the lattice, and that is how we can always create a crystal. And this, the lattice points are essentially like a, you know, when you build a house or build a building, there is a scaffolding all around from which the building is created after that. So this is atomic structure, which is bonding, is essentially scaffolding, and it has a translational symmetry. That means you repeat and the crystal repeats. Generally, there are only 14 ways in which atoms can be in solid can be arranged, and these are on shown here. This is called triclinic, when it's like a, all three sides are not equal and their angles are also not equal. This is called triclinic. Then there is a monoclinic. Alpha is not 90, but the other two angles are fixed, or beta gamma is 90 and alpha is not 90, with a slight variation in sizes, and there is an atomic, additional atoms at the center surface, two surfaces, then it is called monoclinic. Then there is a standard cubic structures which are slightly modified to look as orthorhombic. None of the sides are equal, but their angle can be 90. Then none of the sides can be this, but there can be an atom in the center. We will come back this figure again. And then can be this, when you can have atoms at the surfaces. And then there is another arrangement, which is A not equal to B, not equal to C, but there are additional atoms connected, and we'll see this. These structures are called orthorhombic. These are available. Okay, I just tell you, this is the book which either some of you should jointly buy or Xerox it. Or don't, Xerox is officially not allowed, unofficially I don't know. Just check up if it is available in library. If there are fewer copies, I may order some more. Otherwise, those who are going to remain in the nano lab, they keep saying that they want very high level research going on there, they should at least buy this, okay. For them, this may be a good Bible for them, okay. So the book which I'll suggest is, of course, this is second edition, this is US book of this edition. Indian edition may be in the softbound also, I have no idea. This was purchased 7 years ago. So maybe third or fourth edition, maybe they are not aware. But I have this book. I don't lend anyone, please take from me. I won't lend this book to anyone. $250, okay. So don't come and say, sir, ek din nahi, aadha minute ke liye bhi nahi. Okay, so please either buy, steal, whatever you can do, okay. Don't steal from me, okay. So this book is almost gives everything which I am talking, not necessarily in the order, not necessarily the way I am saying. Some things which I say is may, by the way, Professor Plummer, who is the first author, is the Dean of Engineering at Stanford University, and he was the professor, I mean he is still a professor in the E department. His friend is my friend, or his colleague is my friend, Krishna Saraswat. He's also around same age as mine. We both are from Birla Institute together. He was junior to me. And my son, who was doing PhD at Stanford, did a course with Plummer. So I have met three times Jim. So I can tell you that the way he thinks, he has been the strongest consultant in technology in the Bay Area. Any problem finally comes, they say pass on to Jim, okay, that he may solve it finally. Means some student of his will solve it, okay. There are many IITians who did PhD with Plummer and Saraswat, okay. This is just to give an idea why I am saying you, Plummer is one of the most famous person. Now here is something, rhombohedral, in which none of the angles are equal, none of the sides are equal, or sides may be equal, but shape is slightly tilted. Then there will be tetragonal, A and B, A and C are not equal, other three sides are like this. Then there can be an atom in the center, which is essentially called tetragonal, is called body centered. So there are 14 possible ways in which atomic arrangement can be done, and that's the basic thing we know about. However, as I said already, here is the one which is the cubic lattice which I was just talking. In this cubic lattice, cubic means A, B, C are equal, each angle for this is 90 degree, so it is a cube. The length of each side is A, is called lattice edge, A is called lattice edge. Each material has a different lattice edge. For example, silicon has 5.43 angstrom, gallium arsenide is 5.68 angstroms. So depends on the material, this lattice edge will be different even for cubic or other lattices. Then if you see this second one, you can see from here, there is an atom in the center of the lattice and each is then bonded to corners on every other possible. This is called body centered. And if there are atoms not at the body but every surface, then there are six surfaces, so each atom is there. But very interesting thing you should remember, since it is periodic in nature, how many atoms this cell has? A common cell, one is correct. Why? Because it is a periodic, there is a possibility of another lattice sitting left, right, top, bottom. So eight such corners can meet at a point. So each corner will give you 1/8 atom, eight corners will give only one atom. So edges of the cubic lattice only contributes to one. In body center there are two, because four, eight, one from the corners and one in the center. And the surface, how many?
Four,
because six means they will share with the other ones. So 3 plus 1, 4. However, the one actual structure which we are interested in is silicon, which is neither of them. Okay. Then why are we showing? Because from the face center we will create a structure which is silicon structure, and it has number of atoms are 8. Okay. So let's see how do we get to it. This is just to show you atomic arrangement of a crystal structure. Two different materials shown, gallium arsenide for example. Okay, this Plummer slide, that's why I said you all introduction, this slide was taken from him personally. So all Plummer slides, due regards to him that he allowed me to have them. Only thing he said, don't sell it to in a book. I say fine, I'll not. Here is an arrangement which is non-periodic, random, and since you can see they are random, there is no periodicity and therefore material is amorphous. Crystalline, oh, I forgot there, the mobility of crystalline structure is the highest, amorphous is the least. Now mobility, why it is proportional to this atomic arrangement is the following. Whenever, let's say, electron is given by an atom, like an n-type material or otherwise, and you apply electric field to a solid, so electrons will try to go towards the positive polarity. However, there will be large number of electrons in the crystal, okay. And each will actually interact with this moving electrons, okay. This energy sharing is called relaxation or scattering. So whenever electron starts moving, it hits something and then it loses the path, because once it this, it may shift away. There are many other space charges, there are number of scattering events happens, and not all electrons in the amorphous are possible to reach to the positive terminal. That means the mobility of average mobility of a carrier in an amorphous material is very, very low. Okay. Whereas in case of single crystal, since they are all atomic arrangement, if electron is moving between atoms, they hardly scatter except the space charge as it is. Of course, therefore it's not infinite, otherwise it will all of them would have gone. Some will not go even now. And this scattering events reduces the possibility of all reaching there with a given velocity. And this is essentially why crystalline materials show highest mobilities, okay, compared to polycrystalline and compared to amorphous. Of course, is more like an insulator many times. They may have a resistivity of the order of 10 to power 8 ohm centimeter. Semiconductors may have order of say 0.01 ohm centimeter to maybe as high as 10,000 ohm centimeter. Okay. So this is amorphous. Here is the now there is a word, what is it called, packing. You know, this packing is a very interesting word which will be surprised to know. But before, we let me come to silicon first. Okay. This is called a unit cell. The smallest structure of atomic arrangement, lattice as it is, which allows you to repeat itself and create a crystal is called unit cell. Okay, is called unit cell. Please remember, this is unit cell but not a primitive cell. Now this word is very interesting. This is a unit cell but not a primitive cell. We like to see what is the primitive cell for silicon or for any other material. In this blue colored volume, there are how many atoms? 8. It is a cubic lattice, so there are 8 atoms, and you can see they can be repeated on all sides to create the large amount of, large size of crystal. There is also one possibility which is called hexagonal close packing. Some materials do show this. For example, diamond has similar structure, hexagonal. Quartz has similar structure. So hexagonal close pack structure is, you can see on the top there are 6 edges and they are called hexagons. Now this, why I draw this is to show you what is this word packing density. The way packing density was said, that let's say in a body center, you can see from here, the center one is the slightly enlarged version. The actual lattice is shown in the right. So we create a model which is called hard sphere model. Okay. So each atom we blow it by size. Okay. Equal sizes. If they are silicon, they are all atoms are of equal size. So we start increasing from the edges, blowing the size of the atom. Whenever they will touch each other, we say they are, that's the distance between these two. So you can see from here, this sphere corner, this is only shown half quarter of this, but the upper and side part is not shown, where the center one is fully shown. Okay. So if I want to calculate the distance or the between the corner atoms and the so-called body centered atom, how do I calculate? This is the lattice edge. They are at the center. So it is diagonal from any atom. Okay. So how will we calculate? A by 4 square plus A by 4 square plus A by 4 square under root of this essentially is the distance between the two. And since we are trying to make two atoms touch in this distance, this body center and let's say this, so what is the radius of each atom? Half of this. That radius is called tetrahedral radius, R. Maybe we will discuss. So A by 2, A by 2 and somewhere here. So if I want this diagonal, so if this is your body center and if I start increasing the dia of this, then I want to calculate this radius R, isn't it? This radius R. Since each is A by 2, A by 2 and it's a diagonal, so the tetrahedral radius is half of A by 2 square plus A by 2 square plus A by 2 square. So essentially it is A square by 4, A square by 4, so root 3 A upon 8. Is it okay? So this is the tetrahedral radius of this. So what is the volume of this sphere then? 4/3 pi r cube. 4/3 pi r cube is the volume. Is that okay? In the body center, how many atoms are there? 2 atoms. So what we do is, number of atoms into volume divided by cell volume. What is the cell volume? A cube. This is called packing density. So we can say 2 × 4/3 pi √3 a/8. This is not silicon. A is only edge. This is not body centered. Is not silicon.
Body centered. In body centered, R is equal to a root 3 by 4.
A by 2 and A by 2. It's a diagonal. Okay, calculation you can do that. So the problem which I am saying is, if I now calculate this by A cube, you are right, okay. Whatever I get a packing density is typically 78% is the packing density of a body centered lattice. If I do the same analysis for face centered, how many atoms there are? 4? I didn't have the number. So 52% for body centered, face centered are 72%. But if I do for silicon, which is very interesting, that comes out to be 34%. And the number of atoms in silicon are 8. Okay. So which looks very funny that there are 8 atoms in a lattice and the packing is only 34%. Which means the lattice is very loose, impurities can easily come inside the silicon compared to any other material. Therefore, platinum cannot be easily doped, okay, whereas silicon can be, okay. So, the trick about calculation whether impurities can get into a material is decided by the impurity you are talking, size of that impurity, as well as how much available space for you to enter inside a lattice where it can still bond with the atoms and does not create any strain. The most important word is it does not create any strain. So without straining, how many atoms can get in is essentially per cc if I calculate is called concentration. So I am interested to know how much concentration I can have in impurities in a silicon crystal, so that I can say, okay, this much atoms or impurity atoms are available, and once I know if any or NDs are known to me, then I can do all kinds of calculation for my device parameters and therefore my circuit performance. So to essentially to know how much, I am trying to understand what's happening actually. Though many times you may be right or I may be right. Anyway, wafers do not, no one manufactures wafers in the world other than some few manufacturers, okay. Maybe Wacker Chemie is one, Monsanto is one, Japan is, Leica is one. Because the process of making silicon wafer is very, very costly. Typically, silicon wafer plant from polysilicon to silicon is around $1 billion, typically. And they can't do more than 8 inch. If you have more sizes, you need even costlier. And if you make large number of wafers, the users are only fixed. Okay. So if every company has its own crystal growth system, they will be just putting their use of their crystal growing this 10% of the available capacity. So that is a big loss. And in industry, anything which is idle, including humans, are thrown out. Okay. So idle is the worry for everyone, and therefore the capacity remaining idle also is not encouraged. So just think of it, why no one makes silicon as a material. They get it, buy it from somewhere at relatively higher cost because someone makes for you. However, he or she can supply you of any kind of dopants, any size of wafers with defect density as what will come, as much as you specify, okay. This is something very, very important, okay. So here is a face centered, and here is, okay, hexagon. Before we go to the other packing density of our silicon, I'll come back. There is something we need to know of the crystals, the directions. Because if you look at, if this, the way it is shown here, this is the surface of the wafer. And this direction is 100 of the crystal. Because the mobility of electrons in silicon is highest along 100 direction. Okay. Now, as I said, for a circuit, I am looking for higher mobility. And if I see 100 highest this, so I must have a crystal which is coil has a 100 plane, and the direction is such that it is orthogonal. Direction means if this is your plane, this is your direction, because you can create crystal like this. So if this is your plane, this is your direction. So we want to create a known plane of the wafer, which we'll use in the case of MOS transistors as well as bipolar. Bipolar transistors normally are 1-1-1 oriented. MOS transistors are always, or not necessarily always, now they are changing. They are going for 110, but most cases it was 100. For FinFETs, 110 plane may be better, at least for some characteristics, but for a normal MOS transistors, 100 planes are most preferred planes. Okay, so we like to see why we are looking into this, because I keep referring you back to circuit, because that is where my ultimate performance is. I am looking for circuit performance. I am not interested in all this jumbug if that doesn't help me to improve what I am really looking for. What are we really looking for? High speed circuit, large density circuits, okay, low power dissipation. Since I have parameters in my mind, if I look the technology back, I will start looking, if I do this, where it hurts, where? Can I improve here? If I improve, can I do that there? Some way we are trying to match best of technology to the best of requirement of designers or system users. So please take it that this whole course was planned in 80s when I joined IIT Bombay, was because I thought that most of the Indians, including myself maybe, we are very much shy of doing technology, and more so in 2014 now, with so much of laptops and what iPads and pads and whatever it is, the tendency is only to work on everything on CAD tool. Everything can be seen. Okay. So why do it? Okay. Unless you do it, like for example, other day I made a joke also, you can do everything on CAD tools, computer aided tools, design tools. You can create almost a reality which is called virtual. The only catch is, can anyone inside a screen give me a cup of coffee which I can drink? If that's so, that day I'll say CAD is very good. Okay. Till that happens, someone has to give me in hand something which is real, that all other things remain virtual. If you go to Japan, 90% of their scientists or even professors actually work on technologies. And why they are so, of course they are not doing well recently, but why they did so well? Because they are the best of technology. Why US does so well? Because they have the technology. We don't have technology. We always have CAD tools. Infosys is our ideal. I can fill up some data for LIC, I have to do something, change the date, I say Y2K, and I say I know a lot of computer science. God forbid, okay. All said and done, the course is therefore was written then that at least introduce our students to a hard job, which is actually realization. Okay. Good sake, now in 2010 or onwards, or maybe 2008 onwards, we had a good facility now to make devices, circuits also. No one makes circuits, but at least devices, at least study of materials. Technology is being worked out. It's good to work on technology and see what's going on, because unraveling a mystery is the Nobel Prize winning work. Okay. There are directions of the crystals. The way it can be shown in a cubic is the following. You can see from here, you can start from any point. So A, C, B are the corners, they say. Then you can either take X here, Y here. So this is your origin. This is your origin. Then the X, Y, and the top one is Z, each have a lattice edge A, okay. So you can see, if I have for each BCC, FCC, I have actually shown the same directions, and then we define planes, okay. Once you see X, Y, Z, you can at least make one lattice, one cubic, and you say X, Y, and Z, but these are arbitrary. You can call Z, X, Y, there is nothing very specific. It's only a matter of my decision or people whose copy I am making, their decision. Okay. So once I decide this is my axis, okay, and this access is easy because it's an orthogonal system. So a plane which has an, like for example, it is changed in this case. This is my origin. So x is on this side, y on this side. So what we define a plane is, we find if there is an intercept on whichever axis, okay, that we will call 1. Since this red colored one does not have any intercept on y, because for this plane y remains constant, z remains constant, but x is varying. If I move like this, x will be varying. So I say it is 1, 0, 0 plane. There is no intercept on y and z, so 0, 0. There is an intercept on x, you can see here. Since there is a variation on this crystal will be pulled like this, so this plane is moving. Therefore, this has a variation in x, so it has 1, 0, 0 plane. If I want to make 1, 1, then I must take a diagonal of that and put a plane across, and then there is a y and x both has intercepts, whereas z is constant. So this is moving like this, therefore it is 1, 1, 0. And if all three are varying, then it's like a triangular shaped plane, 1, 1, 1. Okay. So as I said, in most cases, MOS transistors use 1, 1, 0 plane wafers. And as I said, recently, we are looking for 1, 1, 0 for particularly for FinFET, multi-fin, FETs now we are looking for. Maybe this may be a better idea. Okay. So why I am looking for plane? Because plane has something to do with mobility. And since my aim at the end of the day is to get highest mobility, I will try to get, of course this is not the only way I will improve mobility, but this is one possible way. At least starting should be good, then worst is going to happen. Then I will again try to improve on that. But before that worst happens, start should be as good as possible. Now here is a silicon structure, you can see, now this we are not shown. Here is the silicon structure, which is most important. What is done in silicon is, it is a face-centered lattice. Two face-centered lattice are interspersed, pushed in, okay. 1 by 4, 1 by 4, 1 by 4, and 1 by 4. I repeat. Two FCC lattice, you take it, put inside, get from one corner 1 by 4, 1 by 4, and 1 by 4. So if you shift 1 by 4, 1 by 4, the one edge of lattice from there will enter the first FCC near the corner. This, for example, this one or this red one, these are the four which are 1 by 4, 1 by 4, 1 by 4 from the lattice edge, okay, that is one of the atoms. So this 1 by 4, 1 by 4, so there are from four sides, the other atoms will be the above one, similar lattice will be above, so the other combination will go above. Part of this will be then go in the topmost portion. This one has come from one lattice which has gone in, this one has come from this lattice, the other is coming from into the next lattice adjoining this. So if you now see, it is A by 4, A by 4, A by 4 inside, okay. So there are how many atoms now? I said 4 from which are directly gone in, 1 from the corner, and 3 from the surface. So there are 8 atoms in silicon lattice. And if I multiply, and now what is the radii now? Because it is half of, please remember, it is A by 4 is the distance and diagonal distance. But actually radius will be half of that. So you have, this is A, this is A by 4 only. So A by 4 square plus A by 4 square plus A by 4 square, under root of that, then calculate number of atoms, divide by a cube, and you will get this number as 34% packing density. But you see the lattice, how much packed it looks, okay. Now they are saying it is the most loosely packed lattice. There are it has only packing density of 34%, okay. Whereas FCC has 52 and BCC has even higher, What does that mean? That is a loose packed lattice, so you can't introduce impurities there. Where here, limb seems to be a little funny, but that's what the whole game is. A silicon lattice allows, because it has the lowest packing density, more impurities to come inside, and therefore it can dope itself to N kind or P kind or any other impurity can be introduced. This is very, very crucial in our decision to make any material useful for device. Okay, before I go to the crystal growth, there is another fault, you know, there are some interesting faults occur during growth. For example, this lattice, this lattice was being grown, and suddenly we figure out that one atom is missing, for example. Between that, the atom is missing. Missing atom is called vacancy. Missing atom is called vacancy. Please remember, though it seems a fault, as I keep saying, it's a fault or it's a defect, if there are no defects, particularly vacancies, there cannot be any doping at all. Is that correct? So doping essentially is decided by available vacancies. So even if during the growth of a material you create a defect which you really thought it's a defect, it has actually helped us to incorporate impurities. There is a possibility between the lattice, there is a fourth portion, there is additional space between the lattice, in between atoms, that is called interstitial. Between the space available to you, there is a space where atom can go and sit. So these atoms, for example, can be called interstitial. So this is another defect which essentially is available. Further, if you start moving from left to right, suddenly we find there is an additional plane of atoms have appeared, the red line. Red line is additional atomic plane has appeared. The earlier ones, let's say we have only 7 atoms in height, now there are 8 there. This additional atom, you can see now the bonding is upper 3 are bonded, lower 4, but the one where the additional plane has no bonding with the earlier left part of it. And this is additional plane, this essentially is called, the area where it starts is called dislocations. Okay, you have dislocated the material. And the plane through which this dislocation is continuously seen is called stacking fault. Okay. Stacking fault can be one dimensional, three dimensional. Okay. And there is a possibility that this silicon atom may get some other atoms bonding there, like oxygen in specific case. It's called precipitation. So the defects which during crystal growth one sees are the following. One is the vacancy, interstitial, and then dislocation, stacking fault, precipitates. We don't want precipitates, we don't want stacking faults, we don't want dislocations, but we certainly want vacancies. Okay, we certainly want vacancies. So to create any device, we need to dope and we need vacancies to be created. So we'll see how they can be generated in actual crystal growths. Okay. This is a very interesting, because these defects are material property during growth, because you are going from high temperature to low temperature. We will see this. This will appear irrespective whether you want or you don't want. You can make some correct games to minimize this number, okay, but cannot actually avoid it. But certain techniques do allow most of the dislocation to move towards the edge, okay, outside the wafer or edge of the wafer. So the center of the wafer is very good, the edge is very bad, so you grind that out, okay, you say remove them out. That's why there's someone asked other day, circular wafers are always circular, because edge, we want to edge out, remove the all dislocation from the edges. Okay. So is that okay? Extra line of atom is stacking fault, because of which it dislocates the material, and there are possibilities of oxidations or carbon atoms may replace silicon, which is called precipitates. Now these are essentially the problems in crystal growths, and we'll see now how crystals are pulled actually to get and how they are doped. What kind of doping I am expecting? Uniform. If I say Na, the chip may have 200 chips, wafer may have 200 chips, each may have 10 million transistors. For each of them, I want this to be known exactly. Doping should be uniform, because my designers have chosen Na as 10 to the power 17 per CCN derivative. Now, if every part of the transistor is varying, every chip to chip varying and a wafer to wafer starts varying, then there is no way we can say that the performance is guaranteed, because VGS minus VT is the current, VT is varying, so is the current, so is the speed, so is the noise margin, so is the power, so everything varies as soon as this is not attained, and therefore control is the major crux in all technologies. Have you been through? Before we go to technology, these are the three defects again shown here. This is two-dimensional picture. One can see, this atom is missing during growth. So, it's a vacancy. This atom has additionally sat between the open space. It's called interstitial. And this, an atom was otherwise fine, but moved from one place to the interstitial side, and by doing so what it did, it created a vacancy. The pair of such interstitial and vacancy pair is called Frankel fault. Please remember, this has not changed the lattice, it has actually come and sat there. In this case, atom during growth itself was missing, whereas here the lattice was fine, however one atom during cooling somehow jumped. Okay. So, it created a pair of vacancy interstitials. All of these will contribute to doping technologies as well as doping concentration availability, and therefore these defects are very crucial to know about. At a given temperature, these numbers will change. So, as much doping will change as the available faults with you. Is that okay? Vacancy is missing atom. Interstitial is additional atom in the void, and Frankel, an atom moves from one to go to void area and leaves a vacancy down, is called Frankel. Is that okay, everyone? So now we start with crystal growth. Silicon dioxide is popularly available in the earth as sand. It is the second largest material on the crust of earth. Water is one. Okay. Second largest material on earth is sand. So, as far as your supply of silicon is concerned, it is like a sun source. There is enough radiation for many, many million years. Sand is always available. Okay. You require a very small amount of sand to create silicon, but there is enough amount of sand available. So, we start with SiO2 and we want to create finally wafers. So, here is a quick path. Okay. First thing we'll that is the processing we will do. First thing we will somehow make it from sand to a silicon, which is called metallurgical silicon. Why this is called world has metallurgical grade silicon? Because in most steel technologies, one of the byproduct is silicon actually, okay, most steel technologies. To harden the steel, we add carbon and also silicon. And so, major metallurgical silicon is a byproduct which is actually not usable otherwise by any industry, is the actual available source. So, we need not actually need to have sand. Actually, so much Mg grade silicon is available from steel industry. It can feed another 50 years for us, and this will continue to go so much. So, we hardly have to do conversion from sand to Mg grade. But let us say if I do not have silicon industry, steel industry, then what? So, I have sand. I can go to Mumbai, one of the beaches, collect sand. So, here is a sand to metallurgical silicon. I treat with hydrochloric acid and we will see what. and I convert it itself into a gas or liquid, depends on kinds of treatment I do. It's called chlorosilanes. I may distill it. By distillation, I can improve the purity of particular silane I use. We'll use show you this. Then I get the high purity trichlorosilane as shown here. Then I pass through a Siemens reactor, which is called polycrystalline silicon. I reduce this silane, trichlorosilane into silicon, and it deposits by a process called chemical vapor depositions. Then I actually put it into a some kind of a reactor, which is called puller, where I actually melt the poly pieces, actually melt, okay, heating by 1412 and above. Once I start heating the silicon, it melts. Then I put a single crystal on the top, okay, touching this liquid, and start pulling that single crystal rod. If you have done, these days no one does experiment home, so, but just for the heck of it. In earlier times, we had in fifth or fourth class an experiment to be done at home to grow sugar crystals and sodium chloride crystals at home. So school is to supply the so-called wire. This is horse hair. You have to tie up with a good crystalline material, which you make a solution, dip it there, and you say that will grow up next few days. Okay, this was an experiment done in 50s by me. And same technology is used in silicon, okay, nothing great. Once you have a rod of crystal which is highly pure, then you actually saw it, cut it into wafers, polish it, and these are polished wafers available for you, okay, which is what our technology is. So today we start with this, at least one or two of them will finish, and we'll show you that how do I go about from sand to the polished silicon. Sand is damn cheap, very, very cheap. Just to convert from here to here, you may have a $1 billion industry to put. From here to here, another $1 billion. Okay. So to create a polished silicon wafers is a very huge, costly business. Okay. This polished silicon is very interesting material because this is most likely to be used by solar cell people, because it is better than amorphous, not as good as single crystal, but cheaper, okay, compared to the actual wafers you get. So the current technology for solar cells is essentially using polysilicon, and of course their efficiency is not 24% or 28%. They may have 12% to 14% efficiency. Amorphous has 3%, 4%. Crystalline may be 24%, 28%, even higher these days in some other materials. Silicon, of course, is not showing very big. So we'll see. To first process we'll go. You can see from here, this is a reactor in which this is a quartz reactor, okay, and with carbon liners inside. Okay, these are carbon electrodes. What is this furnace called? It's called arc furnace. Okay, when you apply electric voltage across the two electrodes, depends on the in between gap, it creates an arc. Arc temperature can be 3000 degrees centigrade. So you have an arc furnace. Okay, you introduce quartz and carbon together from the top. Okay. Here, due to this arcing between the two electrodes, the temperature here is around 3000 degrees centigrade. It melts silica. Okay. It melts silica. 3032 is the actual melting temperature, but it starts melting. But we have already introduced carbon along with it, and here is a reaction which happens there. The final reaction is SiO2 plus 2 carbon is silicon Mg grade plus 2CO, around 2000 degrees centigrade, somewhere on the top surface, lower surface. Is why lower surface, highest temperature is here actually, where the arc starts. Okay. So we get silicon grade plus carbon monoxide, and that is taken out. Okay. And you can see the liquid, this actually comes out, is collected into silicon metallic grade, and it solidifies. Okay. There are intermediate reaction for those who feel I might have suddenly wrote this. So there are many reactions. At around 1500 degree, the SiO2 breaks into SiO bond and SiO plus carbon monoxide reacts with form SiO2. Si and then carbon dioxide. Then this SiO also reacts with carbon to form silicon carbide. Then silicon carbide and SiO2 themselves react to form silicon SiOCO. And this is multiple reactions keep doing, and around 2000 degrees centigrade, the final reaction SiO2 plus 2C is SiMg plus CO is the final reaction. There are some more in between, but I thought too many will not, you will feel bad, how much chemistry. So I thought, okay, this is enough. So you can see using an arc reactor, the first process was to get silicon out of silica. So we got it now. So once I get this material, then since it is collected somewhere in the trough, when it solidifies, you actually break into pieces as shown earlier. Okay. This is silicon metallurgical grade this. Now I want to create from this, I would like to convert into pure silicon. Metallurgical grade silicon has many impurities, almost all kinds of including carbon is the highest, but many other impurities, strontium is there, nickel is there, even the iron is there, and their sulfates are there, so many impurities, so that's not a good silicon material. I want to create highly pure. Why I'm looking into highly pure silicon? Because I am going to dope this silicon wafer or silicon material by a given concentration of impurities. Typically, silicon concentration is 5 into 10 to the power 22 per cc for a given good silicon. I want to dope it 5 into 10 to the power 14, 15, 10 to the power 16 per cc, 17 per cc, which means I am doping roughly one part per billion or one few parts per million. So if initially itself there are impurities and I introduce afterwards, I don't know how many are I have. Okay. So I want to make highly pure silicon to start with so that when I start introducing impurities, the concentration which I want to achieve that because my circuit performance is hurt on that. So I am always worried that pure initially wafer should be highly pure as possible and only doped with the impurities of my choice to a given concentration. Okay. So this, the first process to purify it is using a flute based reactor. Essentially I didn't bring the, because a big figure, one can see it, you treat it with hydrochloric acid and it forms what is called as trichlorosilane. And this temperature, this is very low temperature process. It is around 300 degrees centigrade. Silicon react with HCl and you form chlorosilane. Now, why I wrote only one of them? Depending on the temperature I choose, I think some chemistry you may read, there are two ways of reaction to happen. One is called the thermodynamically controlled reactions. The other is called kinetic based reactions. In this case, it is the thermodynamic based reactions which I am controlling. So if I change my Gibbs free energy, what is Gibbs free energy? Anyone? Thermodynamics, IIT mein nahi koi padhate, aur bahar to padhate honge. What is Gibbs free energy? If you have done thermodynamics course, very first few lectures we introduced the term entropy, which is order of which is the measure of disorder. It is delta H, which is called energy of formation or called enthalpy. So H is enthalpy and S is entropy. So H delta H minus T delta S is essentially your delta G, change in Gibbs energy. So at given temperature, this both H and S, T delta S can change. And because of that, delta G can change. If it is positive, reaction will be from left to right. If it is negative, reaction will be from right to left. That's what the thermodynamic reactions are. Okay. So by making a choice of temperature, I can create varieties of chlorosilanes. One, of course, is dichlorosilane. SiH2Cl2, then I can create of course monochlorosilane also SiH3Cl. I can create all chlorine atom replacing hydrogens, these four atoms to silicon. So I get silicon tetrachloride SiCl4, or everyone gets only hydrogen out of HCl and we get what is called as silane SiH4. So essentially we say silane, if I replace one hydrogen atom, it is monochlorosilane. If I replace two hydrogen atoms, it is dichlorosilane. If I replace three hydrogen atoms, I create trichlorosilane. And if I replace all four hydrogen atoms, it is silicon tetrachloride. Silicon tetrachloride is a liquid, all others are gaseous forms. Silane is very, very, very highly flammable material. What does that mean? This English has also changed in my time. We used to call inflammable materials, okay. Inflammable material means which takes the fire fast, okay, or which fires itself fast. But of late, Oxford Dictionary last 30 years said, inflammable may actually contradict the flame. Therefore, it's only called flammable. English. So, the SiH4 is extremely flammable material. As soon as you release in the air, the 27 degree centigrade, hydrogen will blast it out, okay. From silicon, which is a silicon trichlorosilane, we want to create polysilicon. And please remember, in between I forgot, this trichlorosilane is done what is called as fractional distillations. You have done some chemistry, a condenser mein ek liquid dalte, heat karte hai, ek upar knob rehta hai, usko collect karte upar. So every has a density, so it collects a different this cooling, and therefore you can have pure silicon trichlorosilicon gas coming out at one end of the port. So once that highly pure trichlorosilane gas is there, we use another reactor which is essentially called Siemens reactor. Okay. There are modifications to Siemens reactor, but process is similar. So you can introduce trichlorosilane, you can also introduce silane, dichlorosilane, anything, but I have used the most famous present day technology, trichlorosilane. So what I do is, this is, you know, you can see here, this black portion is a called silicon bridge. Internally there is an electrode which is a silicon core. This is a electrode and this is silicon core. This is polysilicon rod which is inside which we have heating element. Now what we do is we connect this heating element to a power supply. This is a inverter based system which gives pulses of power. Okay. Power electronics bhi lagta hai jab ye banate hum. Then we have a reaction which is around 1000 degree centigrade, silane, trichlorosilane reacts with hydrogen which is also introduced to create silicon. And that silicon deposits, it's a, and this is normally kept in a particular vapor pressure which is essentially better than vacuum. So it's filled with nitrogen, okay. It's first evacuated and some nitrogen is filled and then only hydrogen reaction starts. If you don't do this, hydrogen may still blast it, okay. So there is some level up to which hydrogen should be allowed in. These are all precautions which you actually take when in the lab as well. So what happens? This rod gets silicon depositions already available and keep, this is called vapor phase depositions, chemical vapor phase, CVD as the word. So the rod becomes thinner to wider, okay. And after sufficient amount of thickness which it can hold, you stop the process, take this out. Bake them all this poly, highly pure poly rods into a small pieces which are called nuggets. And these nuggets will then be used to create single crystal silicon rod, which is what we are shown. That's on Friday.